Numbers on the number line obey the principle of transitivity. If A is greater than B, and B is greater than C, then we know A is also greater than C. While this intuitive property holds true for numbers, it doesn't hold true for everything. Let's take a look at voting in a democracy, for example. Imagine that in a democratic society, citizens are voting on what policy to make into law. One voter likes policy A, has policy B as a second choice, and dislikes policy C. Another voter prefers policy B, then policy C, then policy A, and a third voter prefers policy C, then policy A, then policy B. If there were a vote between policies A and B, policy A would win, since two of the three voters prefer policy A. If there were a vote between policies B and C, policy B would win. So A is preferred over B, and B is preferred over C. We might think transitively that A should be preferred over C, but if there were a vote between policies A and C, policy C would actually win. So voter preferences in general don't follow the rules of transitivity. This creates an interesting dilemma. Imagine policy C were the current policy in our society, and we held a vote on whether to switch to policy A. Based on voter preferences, we wouldn't switch. Our society thinks policy C is better than policy A. But if we first vote on switching to policy B, and then vote on switching to policy A afterwards, our society will first switch from policy C to policy B, and then switch from policy B to policy A. And there's the key problem for our democracy: manipulation of the agenda. In other words, the choice and order of the policies we vote on can completely change which policy we end up with. With one agenda, we stuck with policy C over policy A. With another agenda, we switched to policy A. With the help of some math, we can explore the implications of this further. To do this, we need a way to represent policies numerically. Policies like budgets, healthcare policy, or criminal law consist of multiple components. In a budget, for example, you might spend some amount on one program and some other amount on another program. So we can plot those components in space, each component on its own axis. A policy, then, is represented by a single point in that space. A policy that spends more on one particular program, for instance, might be represented as a policy that's shifted to the right along some axis. Let's also imagine that every voter has some ideal policy, some point in this space that would be their most preferred policy. This gives us a way to represent voters' preferences. Here, we assume that a voter will always prefer a policy that is geometrically closer to them than a policy that is further away. Given two policies, when a voter decides which to vote for, the voter can measure the distance between themselves and each policy and choose the policy that's the shorter distance away. After all, that's the policy that's closer to the voter's true ideal. With that setup in mind, we can now see how a series of well-chosen votes can produce a particularly undesirable outcome. Here's a society with five voters, each of which is at some ideal policy. We'll represent the current policy of this society in blue. Right now, the current policy seems pretty good, and seems a reasonable compromise between what everyone wants. Now imagine we want this alternative policy, colored in red, passed into law. It's far away from the voters, so it seems like there'd be no way voters would ever choose the red policy over the current policy. Yet with our knowledge of the power of agenda setting, we can find a way. The goal is to propose one alternative after another that a majority of citizens will vote for. And somehow, we ultimately want to convince voters to support a policy that seems much worse. With five voters, the key idea will be this. Each time we propose a new policy, we'll make it slightly better for three of them, a majority, but much worse for the other two. How will we choose that policy? Well, remember that a voter will vote for a new policy if it's geometrically closer to them than the current policy. Therefore, if we draw a circle centered at any voter, with the current policy sitting along the edge of that circle, all policies that are more preferable than the current policy must be inside that circle. So we can say that a voter will vote for any policy as long as it's inside of their circle. So let's pick three voters and draw circles around them. The overlap between these three circles is the region inside all three circles. In other words, it represents the policies that these three voters will all prefer. We can now pick a point in that region that's slightly better for these three voters, but much worse for the other two. Now we repeat this process. Pick a different set of three voters and draw their circles. The overlap region represents the policies these three would prefer, and we pick a policy that's slightly better for these three, but much worse for the other two. And now we repeat again. Each time we propose a new alternative, a majority of voters will find it better than the current policy, so the alternative will always win. But because voters who oppose the policy are always hurt more than voters who support the policy are helped, by repeating this process long enough, we can get a policy further and further away from the voters' true preferences. Repeating this enough times, we'll eventually find a policy so far removed from voters' preferences that everyone would prefer the red policy. By playing voters against each other, we, the agenda setters, have caused them to agree on a policy that's much worse for everyone than the policy they began with. We did this for 5 voters in a 2-dimensional space, but this principle works for more voters and more dimensions too. There are rare cases where voters perfectly align such that there's a median policy that won't be voted against, but even the slightest deviation from this perfect alignment, and it always becomes possible to construct some agenda to get any policy passed. Of course, the world doesn't work precisely this way. Policies aren't points in space, and voters don't necessarily blindly vote for whatever policy is closest to their views. But even so, sometimes a model of the world, even if imperfect, can bring about useful insights. And here, the takeaway is the power of the agenda setter, and how it can rival the combined power of voters who only look out for their own interests. But that power can break down. If we are citizens in this geometric world, we have a way to stop the agenda setter's plan by cooperating with each other and agreeing not to vote for marginal gains for ourselves when it means making others in our society much worse. That means our vote can't always be whatever policy is closest to what's ideal for us individually. We have to take into account others in our society and what their preferences are too. But if we can do so, in this world at least, the policies we end up with will likely be better for everyone.